So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So we are entering the final period of the session. So I hope you are still with me, and I hope it will be interesting for you what we like to share, me and my colleague of Oracle, in a sec. You know, and it's like it was told. I started my career as a programmer, and I felt I need to say that in this audience, which is really deep technology expertise, opinionated people, you know. So I'm not only a salesperson, I turned into a salesperson in the end, but I started really in a technical environment. And, you know, my first role was as a programmer. And to be honest, when I finished my college, you know, I could enter an insurance company and another company, and I had nice offers, you know. And my father, he really tear them apart. I said, no, you're not going to an insurance, you're not going to bank, you're going to the ICT area. 28 years ago, by the way. I said, but look, beautiful offers, I am going for, no, ICT. And within ICT, IBM is the best, so you go there. And at that moment in time, we still did what our parents told us to do, to be honest. I mean, today it's different. So now you Google and you Facebook and you have, you know, communities opposing that. And, you know, for the first 4 years I was programmer, only 4 years programmer. Today, sometimes youngsters, you know, say after a year program, so, hey, that's done, tick in the box, what's my next steps? So these people will be chairman of IBM when they're 33, baby. Well, I'm not 33 anymore. But I really always love the fact that I started in this technical environment. Because the business we are in the end, you know, is based on, certainly in a company like IBM, on technology. Deep down technology, research and development as a differentiator of the company we are in. So IBM, as you know, is existing 100 years this year. You know, and fundamental words have been around technology, innovation, globalization, and open. You know, open standards, open source, open data by now, and an open mind and an open world, if you will. At this moment, we are finishing in New York the Think Forum. That is where a lot of industry leaders, government leaders are there. And Sam Palmisano, our CEO, is talking there. And the words that came out of that convention in the past two days are basically, you know, that the speed is really, you know, doubling again. You know, the speed is one word that comes up. Secondly, the need for openness, you know, that's really came out of that conference. And the third thing is the need for collaboration. You know, complexity was there, of course, but collaboration was, in my view, the key word. And what does it mean? Is that the issues are becoming so huge, so fast, that if you don't have a common field where you play together, you cannot get it done. So collaboration is the essential word here. So this is about collaboration as an example. So for some of you who have a swimming pool in your garden, not that many, okay. So maybe you have a boat in your garden, nobody? Okay, then I better go to the normal pitch. So this is the world today, you've seen it all. The reason why I show this chart, because I fundamentally believe that everything we do, whether it's software development, hardware development, financing, football, soccer, play, whatever, it's done in a context. And every time it's important that you understand this global context we are in. What you see here from the European environment, only for the past months, if you will, it's basically discussion, upbeat in all the areas. It's not only financial area. You know, it's the volcano as an example. It is food poisoning issues, etc., all over the place. And the fundamental conclusion of this one is that really nobody saw that coming. Of course, some wise guys are saying, well, I knew, I saw it coming. I warned you many, many times. But the speed in which this is coming and the diversity which it brings, it's unpredictable. It's simply unpredictable. So the lesson we learn, we need to come up with solutions, different solutions, different way of working, you know, how to tackle these now and in the future. So my point is, and I come back to that in a sec, open standards, open data, open innovation is a necessity for that. So we are a company who believe in that, who, you know, do these things as well. Our history, you know, connections with Linux, with Java, with WebSphere, open format document, etc. That's, you know, the evidence that we're doing these things. So the context is clear. So, first, how the world is changing. You've seen this, and again, you've seen it many, many times, but I'll tell you anyway. You know, the lowering the trade barriers. I mean, how simple is it these days to do trade in the world here? How simple is it that you know that in some areas the quality and the price of certain products, good or service, are different? As an example, as a company, IBM, maybe 10, 15 years ago, we could ask people from Mexico, as an example, to be part of our global projects. So they could stay in Mexico and we hired their services. At the time, the price was extremely low, but maybe the quality was not good enough. Now you see that people in Mexico improved. The prices come up a little bit, but the quality came up significantly. So the fundamental thing is that things are changing, and some areas where we always thought they are not smart, they are, you know, not progressing, they are. So it's an element that need to take into account. Development of the internet and the explosion of data. You know, all these surveys we do demonstrate that data is exploding in size, in quality, it becomes unmanageable. So therefore, where in the past, and we still are, by the way, are talking about interoperability, I mean, data protection are still the items we need to crack the code for, if you will. But I mean, open standard, you know, is something we know and we do. But open data is the new phenomena that is coming up more and more. And we see that in this explosion. Big data, what you talked about. But think about, make it simple, you know, as a consumer or as a, you know, someone who takes medical care, I want to have that data at the moment I want to have it, you know. So, and that cannot be protected data, part of it, but it needs to be a lot of open data free for people. So the point I want to make on this, things are changing, you know, they're there to stay, so we need to take into account when we go. Organizations need to adjust as well. In my company, we are privileged to have a very visionary board, like more companies, by the way. So 10 years ago, when we saw these things coming, we adjusted a lot of things to be ready for this environment. So one of the things we did, as an example, we changed our, if you will, headquarter organizational structure. Classical, you have a headquarter and you rule the world from that headquarter. Second model, multinational, if you will, you copy headquarters in those countries and you manage from there. We've turned into what we call a globally integrated enterprise model. What it means is basically that we do all the things that the IBM companies needs once in the world. And the way it works is that if I need to close a deal for a client or a government or a societal institution in the Netherlands, then I try to use the services for help desk from South Africa. I use fulfillment systems from Madrid. I use HR systems from Budapest, etc. And you can do that because 10 years ago, we started investing in that. We laid a foundation, we did the processes, we created all these open standards, open data in our company as well, because those are prerequisites, otherwise you cannot play in this format. And of course, again, the first 4 years, the fulfillment service for the world from Madrid is not great. But trust me, after 2 years, it's better. And after a while, you can really rely on that services. So again, this is a prereq. Then we saw this technology changing. And the way this chart goes, ladies and gentlemen, and again, I'm building up this pitch here, is our discussion, our vision on what we call smarter planet. The way it works is that we said, as IBM, this world is becoming or is today instrumented. You all have your devices, you all have three devices, you know, iPads, PDAs, whatever you call it. And trust me, well, we can use it these days as well. You know, it's not only we have it, we can use it. So instrumented, that is more or less done, tick in the box. The second thing, we are interconnected. You know, if you look to the net, etc., we know in a second what is happening in Singapore or California at this moment. So we thought the moment has come to really use all this beautiful environment in a global space, in a standardized environment, and really start becoming intelligent. And not only use your intelligent solutions for your commercial clients, but most effectively use it for societal themes as well, what we will discuss in the past 2 hours. So the issues we have in the water environment, in the energy environment, in the food, in the healthcare, etc., they can be supported by these solutions. That's the point that is behind this one. Now, on open data and open standards, you know, I bet you that if I ask you a definition of open standard, open data, that I get a few from this audience. The only thing I like to share, open standards has to me a few elements of it. The elements of an open standard is to me, number one, that there is an agreement. There's a kind of agreement. Secondly, most important, it is used by many. Even more important, is accepted by many. Fourthly, I would say the development is extremely transparent. And, you know, in the end, I think that's very important. Well, the cost, the fee of using that is or free or it is very, very poor. So those are elements for what I call open standard. Now, the interesting thing is when we go more and more into open data environment, I personally believe these elements, they can be mirrored to open data as well. You know, recently I had a discussion with the mayor of Amsterdam, and like all mayors today, you know, people see smarter cities concept coming to them. So these mayors are stepping up. I said, hey, I am going to be the king of this municipality, so I better shape up and make sure that people like to live and work here. So he said, what's that open data, you know? And I tried to give him some examples. I said, listen, I mean, your entrepreneurs in your city, your SMEs, if you will, these people, they are handicapped. They have so much data that they don't have access about. They even don't know what it is. So if you make that available to these people in a machine-readable format, in the way they want it, they can use that and they can invest their time more in the creativity than only finding all the data together. As a small example. And I think those are the way you need to talk to people about open data. Secondly, he said a tourist is coming into a big city like Brussels, you know. So he likes to see all these things, this congestion of Brussels. Well, that's clear. He doesn't need a site for that, you know, to be honest. But I mean, that's a joke for the Belgian people, not. But I mean, you know, you like to get this data ready fast, you know. And so I said public institutions who ask money before for certain data are going to free that up, you know, and it's going to be used. And you're going to make people accountable for their data, and, you know, you're stepping up to the solutions we need to create for this environment. So the elements are clear. Open standards, open data is something we need to explain in steps more and more to the people we work with. The final chart, and then I give you some examples, is about something I personally call the power of the consumer. So you can talk about, you know, the technology and the open standards and the open data. You can talk about how you organize. You can talk about what the world needs at this moment. But the fundamental element to me is also, I mean, the consumer, the users, the patients, the citizens in the end. I fundamentally believe if we find ways that people start pooling this technology, in fact that we're pushing it to them, you know, it will be a huge difference. Make them more knowledgeable, you know, make them use it. And the good thing is that our youngsters, if you will, I have 2 teenage daughters, they take that much more, you know, fast. They have the technology, they use it in a different way. Secondly, with cloud, with open data, with open, we are providing that much better. So my point every time is, again, much more time can go into creativity to find solutions for the world we need to do, because it's going extremely fast. So those are some examples. Company IBM is investing in 100 years a lot in what we call societal environment. As an example, when we were 100 years old, in June 16 this year, there were no celebrations, you know, there was no big party time, no drinks, nothing. We didn't do that. The gift we gave back to the world, basically, is that we asked all employees of IBM to invest 8 hours of their time into societal issues, if you will, themes. A lot went into education, so many IBMers used their knowledge and their skills of IBM to go into vacation, into classes, etc. So, you know, the point I want to make here is that if you like to help society, you need to do it. You need to make your projects, make your people aware of that, but help the planet further, you know, and that present, if you will, is an example of that, what I wanted to share. Okay, a few examples. You know, I mean, this is about food. You know, an average potato in the UK, you know, is traveling about 3,000 kilometers, if you will, yeah? Other examples is that bananas in the UK as well even travel 6,000 kilometers, tomatoes, if you will. So the point I want to make, in the supply chain, in the food, we are wasting so much. Now you can argue that in great times, you know, let it go. But in the periods we are in, it is not sustainable anymore. We get more people, you know, a lot of people in the world don't have enough food. So this is not sustainable anymore and we have to act here. And we believe that our solutions, standards, open data, our cloud, are elements how we need to do that. So all these things come together to create a solution to fix these items. Another example is the energy stream. You know, we are coming from a world that energy is pretty simple. You know, we create energy, a company brings it to you, you pay the bill, very simple, one-way street. You know today that you in your houses or you in your cars can create energy as well. That's interesting. So you get a two-way street, yeah? So the energy companies, they are saying, what is happening? I need to connect more to ICT companies. Regulation, etc. in the EU environment is changing. So everything is changing because we are starting to do that two-way. Again, an explosion of data, because all this data from these cars, from these houses, from these companies needs to be measured. We need to put it in what we call smart meters. That's the, you know, solution, a solution for this issue. And again, the more open data you provide, the better it is. So that's another solution where all our elements do come back. This is another very interesting one. And we took the example of Rio de Janeiro. So take the following example. You have a smart city. So a smart city, you know, has citizens, it has an infrastructure, and the most important thing, it has connects to many important areas in the city. So like healthcare, like traffic. Now here's the point, you know, some cities are proud that they have instituted a traffic system, yeah? So as example, that's my next chart, the city of Stockholm for 7 years, most of you are familiar with that one, they implemented a solution and it's working. You know, 20% reduction, green cars coming up, food traffic improving with 7%, etc. So they are proud on the traffic system. But other cities have focused on healthcare first. Now the trick is that if you have all these small systems in a city, the real challenge is that you interconnect all these systems and you make a system of systems, if you will. So that if the water flooding in Rio de Janeiro is coming up, you know, the connection to the healthcare system is already there, so people are evacuated, the police files are updated as well, etc. So this whole concatenation, if you will, is working. Again, if all these institutions don't give their data free so that this cockpit can be done, it's not working. So therefore, I fundamentally believe that this openness, you know, is one of the rare solutions for the issues that we have today and are coming to us more and more and more and more. This is a very nice example. And Rio, they approach this because they have their issues already today, but with the Olympics and the champions coming up, wow, it's only the beginning of the issue. So they're investing in this one. So if you have the time, you know, go there. There are more examples in Europe as well. Rome is starting to do something similar. But remember, it's not only the separated systems, but it's the system of these systems, you know. And again, open data is there a prereq for. And if we don't do that, it will not work. Okay, this is an example about the traffic. So coming to a conclusion, you know, IBM company, 100 years, you know, technology is in our DNA, yeah? And we always are proud on the fact that we have an open mind, We support open standards, you know, open data, open source. We are an open company. A lot of the patents we have, we gave back to the world. Yeah, so we worked on that, gave it back to the world. We have examples of that one as well. So the first open software standards are the foundation of the data system of system. That's the point I wanted to say. It will not work without it. That's the first point. Open data in the public sector, you know, is another prereq. And we need to help each other here to explain that to governments in time after time what it is. Because these people don't know. They are coming from a protective environment. They don't want to give this data away, because then it becomes open that maybe, you know, it's useless data or there's no need for the data anymore, you know. We hope to spin it from the other angle, that we say, listen, bring it into the middle and demonstrate the value you can bring for the total picture, if you will. But open data, in my experience over the world, is that a lot of governments still need to do quite some things to understand this and implement it, and there is where we need to help. And finally, there's a reason why so much CEOs today talk about complexity, data, and the need for business analytics. The IBM company, we acquired Pricewaterhouse 9 years ago because we were missing enough business skills in the areas I talked about. 5 years ago, we acquired Cognos because we didn't have enough software to work on business analytics. But we have it now. We have it now with our hardware business. We have it all concatenated. So business analytics, the fact that you have your data at the right moment, at the right time, you know, is going to be essential. So those are some conclusions we learned, ladies and gentlemen, over time, what we think is very important. The theme for this afternoon, open forum, is no debate to me. You know, I'm a fan, we are a fan, that's fine. The reason why I spent a little bit more on the context of it all, the world, if you will, is that we say, how can we bring this knowledge and the expertise we have in this room, bring it together and fix these issues and help the planet to go further. And the final thing I like to say, my two daughters help me every day, my wife as well, but my daughters as well, because in these kids, you know, you see what the world is drifting to, you know, and that is coming to us. So it's so important to look to the consumers of now and in the future as well. That's the total package, what I'd like to leave you with. Thank you for your attention. Hopefully you bring it somewhere in your total conclusion if you go home tonight. Hopefully traffic is better tonight for all of you. I wish you that. And thank you for your attention. Thank you.